Dear everyone, welcome back to the second part of our conference. The second part will be about fat, energy and digestion. We have two speakers here this afternoon. The first speaker will be Professor Walter Gerrits. He is from Wageningen University. And we have André Meuwse. He's our colleague from Famelco. So I would like to invite Walter Gerrits to start his presentation and give him a small applause for starting up.
Well, thank you very much. Can everybody hear me like this? Yes, okay. All right. I would like to start by thanking the Famelco for inviting me to speak here about lipid digestion and metabolism. I work at the Animal Nutrition Group at Wageningen University, and I'm a quantitative nutritionist, so I'm very much interested in the how much question. So today is going to be about lipid digestion and metabolism, and I would like to trigger your thoughts by giving you a proposition to think about. And this proposition is that lipids are a better energy source than carbohydrates, per kilojoule that is. So you can start thinking about this. I will give you a couple of seconds. All right, have you made up your mind? Who agrees with this proposition? There's at least one. I take two. So I guess three, four, five, six. Who disagrees? Who disagrees? There's one at least. Another one. Yeah, great. I like that. A little bit of disagreement here. What I will do is I will refrain from giving my opinion on this issue. But I will try to give you some evidence-based information about what happens to fats in the body, and you can use that information to develop your minds. You know, you don't have to agree, you can disagree, no, not a problem at all. So I will start with giving the contents of the presentation. I will first focus on the digestion and the absorption process of lipids, and more specifically I will discuss the role of the different fatty acids in this process. I have understood that you're quite a mixed audience, so I will start basic, and I hope that I will provide also enough depth information that it will be interesting for all of you. And then the second part of the presentation will be about what happens after the lipids are absorbed in the body. After the fatty acids are available, how does an animal decide to burn it or to store it? Can we use fats to manipulate meat quality? And last but not least, I will discuss with you the effect of fats versus carbohydrates on the optimal lysine to energy ratio, which is, if people are interested in quantitative nutrition, this is what a lot of nutritionists think about every day. All right, a triglyceride, as already mentioned by the previous speaker, usually consists of three fatty acids and a glycerol molecule. So here you have the glycerol molecule and an ester bondage, which is different from the bondage bound that Olga discussed for the product that she was presenting. And you have three fatty acids that are bound to the glycerol molecule. And these fatty acids, these are just randomly chosen fatty acids. The omega here is to indicate that it is this end from which you start counting the double bonds for the omega 3 and 6 fatty acids, but generally these three fatty acids, there are three random fatty acids coupled to a glycerol molecule, and the properties of these fatty acids will determine to what extent they are digested in the animal body. It's not only about the fatty acid composition, and I will also show you some evidence that it makes a difference at what position the fatty acids is esterified to the glycerol molecule. Now, if the fats move along your digestive tract and they disappear at some stage, at least that's the intention, right? It's a result of two different processes, hydrolysis and absorption. And the hydrolysis already starts in the mouth and the stomach, then continued in the small intestine, where you get lipases, esterases, and phospholipases. for which you do need colipase and bile acids. And the absorption process is more or less transporter-facilitated mechanisms. And ultimately, you get in the enterocytes chylomicrons formed, which then are transported into the lymphatic system. Now, this is a schematic picture of a part of the GI tract. The head of the person or pig or chicken should be here, actually. And then you have the stomach, the liver, gallbladder, and then the proximal part of the small intestine with the major secretory organ, the pancreas, there as well. If your fats are entering in the stomach, they are present as an undispersed oil. It's an aqueous environment. They don't mix well with water, which also later on prevents proper digestion unless something is done about it. Gastric lipases, lingual lipases are secreted here. Roughly 90% of the total fats that are present are present in the form of triglycerides. And then the fats move to this proximal part of the small intestine, where they have to mix with water. And for that, you need micelle formation, and that is promoted by the secretion of bile salts, and which leads to emulsification of the fats. And this is what you see here. This is an enlargement of this section. Here is the pancreatic duct coming in. So you have these oil droplets, and it starts to be solubilized inside the lumen of the intestinal tract. Small vesicles ultimately into mixed micelles or micelles, and the proper formation of the micelles is key to the digestion process and depends on a lot of factors. I already told you that 90% of the fats present in the stomach and small intestine is present as triglycerides. The other 10% is present in the form of phospholipids and cholesterol esters. Now, a little bit about what happens in the with gastric lipases and pancreatic lipases. This is a study with piglets. Pre-weaning and post-weaning. The pre-weaning are the open symbols, and the post-weaning are the closed symbols. On the x-axis, you see the body weight, and here is the activity of gastric lipase isolated from the gastric mucosa, and here is the pancreatic lipase from a pancreas homogenate. And please note the difference in units here is far higher in the pancreatic homogenate than it is in gastric mucosa. But interesting to see, I think, is that pre-weaning, you do see an increase in gastric lipase activity, but after weaning, this stops. Whereas it's a bit disturbing if you talk too loud. If you have the pancreatic lipases here, they also increase with body weight pre-weaning, and then the activity drops, probably because of a sudden decrease in fat intake. But if continued, it starts to increase again. Now, having this much lower lipase activity doesn't mean that it doesn't do anything. It particularly does something, and I will show you later, with shorter chain fatty acids, but also there is no bile salts and colipase required here, whereas this is key for the action of pancreatic lipase. And because of the longer retention time of digestion in the stomach, it still may exert some effect on lipid hydrolysis. And in humans, there is literature that, let's say, 10 to up to 30% of the fats can actually be hydrolyzed already in the stomach. Another evidence of gastric lipase activity, it is much higher on shorter chain or medium chain fatty acids than it is on long chain fatty acids. And this is a picture from human neonates, gastric aspirates, taken from children just after birth, classified in three fractions: high activity, intermediate activity, and low activity. And regardless of the difference between these three groups, you see the massive difference between the medium chain fatty acid C8 and the long chain fatty acid. So the activity on the medium chain fatty acid is 6 to 10 times larger than it is on the long chain fatty acid. All right, coming back to the general picture, the gastric and lingual lipases are quite selective on the third position of the fat molecule. So if you have a triglyceride here with a glycerol molecule, position 1, 2, and 3, this is the fatty acid that is being uncoupled by the action of lingual or gastric lipase. You get this fatty acid here, and you end up with a diacyl glycerol. The pancreatic lipases, they do require colipases for their action, and they are also selective, but then on the first and the third position. So they uncouple the first and the third fatty acid from the glycerol molecule, leaving a monoglyceride with the fatty acid coupled to the middle position. And it is important to know that having this fatty acid in the middle position is key to micelle formation inside the intestinal tract. And I will show you also some information that the fatty acids that are coupled to the middle position have a higher digestibility than the ones that are coupled to 1 or 3. All right, and then about absorption. It was already touched upon by the two previous speakers. This is the intestinal lumen. You have micelles here with monoglycerides, fatty acid, actually nicely in micelles, which is not depicted here, taken up by enterocytes. And then inside the enterocyte, they're re-esterified and incorporated into so-called cardiomicrons. And from there, the idea is that they bypass the bloodstream and are actively incorporated into lacteals, lymphatic vessels. And from there, they're transported and they enter the circulation after the liver. Now, in birds, they, as already indicated, they have a different kind of lymphatic system. It's still important, but quantitatively, they're less well-developed lymphatic vessels in chickens. And an important part of the fatty acids are actually entering, the chylomicrons are entering the portal circulation. But it's not black, and that's also why they are called in literature. In birds, they usually refer to as not as cardiomicrons but as portomicrons, because part of them enter the portal circulation. But it's not black and white. Especially the medium and the longer chain fatty acids also in birds can enter the system through lymphatic vessels, and also in mammals you will see that the shorter and medium chain in part will directly go to the portal circulation. So it's a textbook thing here. That pretends that it's really extreme, but I think it is true to some extent that the vast majority of the longer chain fatty acids in mammals will go through the lymphatic system, whereas an important part in birds will go through the portal circulation. Now, if you have a digestibility trial and you get a number on apparent fat digestibility, I think one of the first things you should look at is what kind of fat inclusion percentage did they have in their diet? Because that does determine to some extent the number that you will get. This is a study by Jurgensen and Fernandez with piglets, fat milk replacers, and you can see that there is a strong increase in the fat digestibility percentage with an increasing dose, for the very simple reason that animals always excrete endogenous proteins but also endogenous fats. And at low intakes, proportionally, the contribution of endogenous fats are quantitatively very important. So at low intakes, you see the endogenous fats dominating the fecal fat and thereby causing a low digestibility. So this is a general relationship that you will see in piglets, but they also found a picture in broilers, work of Jurgensen. Also apparent total tract fat digestibility, the same kind of picture, right? Now, it's long known that digestibility decreases with the saturation of the fatty acid. This is a picture by Wiseman in 2015, and he plots here on the x-axis the US ratio, is the unsaturated to saturated fatty acid ratio, and it's quite obvious that the digestibility of a fatty acid will increase quite drastically with an increasing number of double bonds in the fatty acid molecule. It makes it more easy to get micelle formation, and therefore it mixes much better with the intestinal digester. Also, digestibility does decrease with chain length. This is a study in broiler chickens by Willem Smink already a while ago, and he has a digestibility figure for C14, 16, 18, 20, until 24. And generally, you see this nice trend. And there is, this is just an example. There are many more of this type of graphs. What I do think is important to realize that if you have also unsaturated fatty acids, what happens, at least in pigs, is that they will be hydrogenated in the large intestine, and they will end up, if you have C18-1, for example, it will end up after hydrogenation as C18-0, which means that the digestibility of C18-0 in pigs is sometimes close to zero or even negative because of the biohydrogenation, right? All right, I already told you that the positioning of the fatty acid esterified to the glycerol molecule may make a difference in the digestibility. And this is evidence that proves it. It is also research of Willem Smink, who tested in chickens. He compared the digestibility of fatty acids esterified to the first or third position with the fatty acids compared at esterified to the second position. And if you look at the palmitic acid, C16-0, you see an increase in digestibility when it's at the second position. And likewise, you see the same with stearic acid. So it's quite a big difference. It's also difficult to measure this, but it's also been shown in human infants. And I think it's important to note that the effect is even more pronounced with for the saturated fatty acids than for the unsaturated. In the previous graph I showed you, the C18-0 here, digestibility of lower than 40%, it increases to nearly 80%. But the C18-1, which has a much higher digestibility because of its unsaturation, it only increases just a little bit. So in short, the digestibility for fatty acids is higher when the fatty acid is esterified to the second position because of micelle formation, and the effect is largest for the fatty acids with the lowest digestibility, for example, the saturated fatty acids. Now, fatty acid digestibility is also proven to decrease with the free fatty acid content of the fat mixture, also shown here by Wiseman, but I could have chosen many other examples showing the digestible energy content of a fat mixture decreasing with increasing proportion of fatty acids in the mixture. If you look at this is tallow. If you look at soybean oil, you see the same trend, but at a higher level. And the higher level is because of the higher degree of unsaturation for the soy oil compared with the tallow. So the higher the proportion of free fatty acids, the lower the digestion. So in short, summarizing the first section of this presentation, fat digestion starts in the stomach and it increases when the degree of saturation goes down. It also increases when the chain length is shorter, and for the fatty acids that are esterified to the second position, it is higher than to position 1 and 3. And the more free fatty acids you have, the lower the digestibility. And I think many of these aspects are because of emulsifying properties are key to digestion. And the next speaker, André Meuse, will be giving some more evidence how important emulsification is for the fat digestion process. Which brings me to the second part of my talk, which is about post-absorptive metabolism of fatty acids. Now let's start with a simple graph that is made by Bicker, already more than 20 years ago. Pigs in the weight range of 45 to 85 kilos were all fed on a low-fat diet, which is kind of normal here in the Netherlands. And if you increase the feed intake from low to high, you can see that the digestible fat intake in orange here does increase, but the fat deposition increases much steeper. And in adlib-fed pigs, the vast majority of the fatty acids that are deposited in the tissue are made from glucose, from starch, and not because of absorbed fat. And if you look in broilers, this is a picture from Jurgensen, in broilers between 12 and 42 days of age, you can also see that when fed a low-fat diet, the fat absorption is much lower than the fat deposited. And in chickens, it is important to know that the fatty acids that are deposited from glucose, they are synthesized de novo in the liver. Whereas this process in pigs, for example, takes place mostly in adipose tissue. But if you increase the dietary fat concentration, and no doubt this would be true for pigs as well, you would see quite a dramatic increase in absorption of fat. And when it's 18% of fat in the diet, it can happen that fat deposition is not higher than the quantity of fat absorbed. So these are two important things if you talk about fat and fat intake and fat deposition. Now, if you exchange carbohydrates for fats, because that is usually what you do, if you make a diet and you decide to put more fat in there, what you leave out is usually carbohydrates, right? So this is work from David Lamotte, published last year in very, very young chickens, probably chickens between 0 and 7 days of age. This is metabolizable energy intake. In exchange, when you're exchanging dietary fat, you're exchanging dietary carbohydrates for dietary fat. So when you go from left to right, you increase dietary fat and thereby you decrease dietary carbohydrate intake. You see very little effect, maybe a small drop, but not significant on metabolizable energy intake. And if you look what happens to heat production here in orange, it does significantly decrease, but the decrease is rather small, leaving zero effect on energy retention. Also, if you look in these data on fat retention, it's also not affected. So if you take out the carbohydrates, put in the fats in very young chickens, you virtually have no effect on fat deposition. If you look into somewhat older broiler chickens, also work in Denmark by Jurgensen, same kind of design, metabolizable energy intake is not affected, but heat production is dropping quite drastically, and therefore you see also that energy retention, and if you look more in detail, it will be fat retention, is increased. So what happens in older animals, in older chickens, but also in older pigs, if you exchange carbohydrates for fats, you usually get a higher fat deposition, and this is also the reason why we in the Netherlands at least use a net energy system for swine, because the incorporation of fatty acids into body fat is more efficient than producing fatty acids de novo from glucose. Now, an example for pigs, work of Eric Bruinings. He also exchanged carbohydrates either for lard or soy oil in pigs, and this study was designed to give equal digestible energy intake. So that's why these three bars are identical. Metabolizable energy intake was a small difference because of a larger urinary nitrogen excretion in the starch group. But you see, even though the metabolizable energy intake was a little bit lower in the starch group, heat production was not reduced. And therefore, if you look at energy retained, you can see that there is a difference between the animal fat group and the starch group. And the soy group is in between. So similar to what you see in the older chickens is something that you see also in pigs. If you take out the carbohydrates and you put in the fat, you get a higher deposition of fat. But it does make a difference, although here it is not significant, what type of fatty acid mixture you have. And I will show you some information about how you can measure this kind of things. This is measured in the same study, and what he did is he incorporated 13C labeled glucose into the diet. It was fed immediately after feed intake, and the 13C labeled glucose is just as glucose. It's being used in the same way. The only difference is that the atomic weight is a little bit different, and that gives you the opportunity to measure it quite accurately. So it's considered to be one of the best available tracers to follow glucose metabolism. After giving a pulse dose to the pigs, the recovery was measured in breath. And everything that's measured in breath is not deposited in tissues, right? It's just oxidized. And typically what you see here after a meal, this is time zero, that was just shortly after the meal, you see a quite steep increase in recovery and then going down after 15 hours back to baseline. Which means that roughly 50% of the glucose is oxidized And the other 50% is either used for the deposition of glycogen, or it is stored as fat. But it's important to realize here that this happens quite quickly after a meal, going back to baseline. Now, if you do the same thing, but then for fatty acids, so if you buy labeled fatty acids, 13C labeled, then you can do the same thing and just measure when it comes out. And it will tell you how the pigs will use these fatty acids. Now, this is the 13C recovery as carbon dioxide from labeled stearic acid. Time after isotope administration, this was done late afternoon. And what you can see, I think the difference between the three lines are not so much interesting. Interesting is here to observe that immediately after the meal, you see very little oxidation of the fat. It is absorbed, but it is retained in the body. And you do see a peak here, which is the next, is just immediately prior to the next morning meal. So what happens is these pigs will store the fatty acids in adipose tissue. And then after a night of fasting, they will become more active in anticipation of the meal, and they have to fuel this activity, and they burn a substrate for that, and they burn the fat that they have that they have deposited lastly. So what you see here is that you see a peak of recovery of isotope immediately before the next meal. Now the same picture you can make for linoleic acid. You do find a recovery that is slightly higher than the recovery you find here. Also, you have to note that this axis is a little bit different from this axis. But the idea is the same. You see a little oxidation immediately after eating the meal, but the big peak comes at the next morning meal. So what you can learn from this is that oxidation increases with the number of double bonds. So the recovery here is higher than the recovery here. And the principle of last in, first out. This is also probably why you have these two layers in back fat in pigs. I don't know if you have ever seen this, but the older fat will just stay there for quite a long time. So in short, the major portion of body fat is synthesized from starch, and the efficiency of incorporation of dietary fatty acids into body fat will increase with the age of the animals. It will also increase with fat intake, and hence decreasing starch intake. And it decreases with the degree of unsaturation. And last but not least, I think it's interesting to note that you have this principle of last in, first out. All right, and if you want to manipulate meat quality by means of lipids in your diet, it is important to keep in mind how much of the fat is actually ending up in tissues, right? It's also interesting to see where it ends up. And this is a trial which doesn't give you very significant results, but I think it gives you interesting results. It was done by Willem Smink a while ago. And I show it to you because it's a large-scale practical trial that we see quite a bit in practice. An experimental contrast that is very relevant. It's not too big of a contrast, right? So it was starch replaced by a mixture of 3% of soy oil and 1% of palm oil, or by 4% of palm oil. A lot of things were measured, and the interesting thing here, I think, is that the intramuscular fat content of the most saturated fatty acid mixture was lowest. It was a tendency. So we started, when seeing this, we started looking, is there more information with larger contrast that we can substantiate this difference? Is it true that when you make fatty acids from glucose, that they end up in intramuscular fat instead of in back fat, for example? And I think this is interesting when you want to manipulate the meat quality by means of fat nutrition. And I found some information published in 2010, also pigs of 60 to 100 kilograms body weight, larger contrast, 10% starch replaced by 10% of tallow, 10% of high oleic sunflower oil, or 10% normal sunflower oil, or 10% of linseed oil, and looking into the intramuscular fat content in either ham or loin. And what you see is that the ham was not affected, but you see quite a big effect on intramuscular fat content in the loin tissue. And the intramuscular fat content was highest in the starch and lowest in the linseed and the tallow oil. They don't give a good explanation for that, but I do think it's important to note that when you're synthesizing fatty acids de novo, that in some tissues they will end up preferentially as intramuscular fat, but not in all tissues. Now, if you want to create an added value for your meat, it's also interesting to try to manipulate the fatty acid composition. And I think it's quite obvious that if fatty acids are incorporated directly into tissues, by choosing your fatty acid profile of your diet, you can influence the fatty acid profile of the meat. One of the key questions is, can you also manipulate the fatty acid content of the long-chain polyunsaturated fatty acids, the ones that you have health claims for? Now, the most easy way, of course, is just to feed them directly by microencapsulated algae or whatever mixture, fish oil that was done in the past. But can these animals also make these fatty acids themselves by feeding the precursors? And if you want to decide this, it's important to know how it works. This is the omega-6 pathways, and this is the omega-3 pathway. Starts with the precursor linoleic acid, and you can see here that you have a number of elongation steps and desaturation steps. So you get more longer chains, but also more double bonds. You have arachidonic acid here. Now, in the omega-3 line, you start with linolenic acid, and you have EPA, DPA, and DHA in your as products in your line. And it's important to note that for all these steps, you need enzymes. You need desaturases to introduce double bonds. You need elongases to make additional fatty acid carbon atoms to the fatty acids. But these are shared between these pathways. So if you feed a lot of alpha of linoleic acid, you might inhibit the conversion of alpha-linolenic acid into EPA, for example. Now, these are the fatty acids that are of interest. Arachidonic acid, present in your brains, a lot of membranes. It is there to allow a certain flexibility for physiological function of a lot of important cells in your body. And you have EPA, DPA, and DHA here as the main products that you would like to have. I think DHA and EPA are widely known. DPA is less known, but there is increasing evidence that also DPA is an analog for EPA, and it has quite similar functions with regard to promoting cardiovascular health. So it's an interesting one to look at, I believe. And this is a study in which Willem Smink was trying to manipulate the production of EPA, DHA, and arachidonic acid just by feeding more precursors and looking at the effect of the precursor on the formation of these fatty acids, but also looking if there was an antagonism, if you get less arachidonic acid, for example, if you feed alpha-linolenic acid. And what you can see here for EPA, you can see that it's stimulated when you feed a lot of alpha-linolenic acid, right? So you increase from here to here in the liver, you see a lot of EPA arising there. Also, when you do have high linoleic acid and you add alpha-linolenic acid, you still see an increase in EPA, but the increase is less big. So there's a little bit of antagonism there. DHA, nothing much happens, so you cannot really increase the DHA content in the liver by means of feeding the precursors. Arachidonic acid is interesting to see that you already have quite a high content if you feed no or virtually no linoleic or alpha-linolenic acid, but it's inhibited by feeding omega-3 fatty acids. So what happens actually is that the effect of the precursor is less big than the inhibition effect of the other one. So you can influence the arachidonic acid content in the liver just by feeding the substrate, but you can inhibit it by feeding the other one. Now, if you want to increase the EPA content in muscle, it's been shown in literature many times that there is a positive relationship. So you can see here the concentration of alpha-linolenic acid in the diet and the EPA content in muscle. I'm sorry about these X's here. But you generally see over different references that there is a strong response and it is positive. A similar response you can get for DPA.
but not for DHA. It just simply doesn't work. The animal does not have the enzyme systems in muscle to put the last desaturation step. So in short, fatty acid composition in meat is quite heavily influenced by the composition of the dietary fat, and it depends on the quantity of fat that is used for ATP production. That's a general statement, right? Intramuscular fat you can stimulate by de novo fatty acids from starch, but it doesn't work in all tissues. And EPA and DPA, but not DHA, can be produced by the animals themselves by just feeding more of the precursor in their diet. Well, which brings me to the last part of the presentation. If you now compare fatty acids with starch, does it affect the amount of protein that you have to put in the diet? Is the amino acid requirement depending on the energy source that you provide? And before I can show some results here, I need to explain how we measured the optimal lysine and digestible energy ratio in pigs. So this was done by Esther van der Hoek a while ago, and what she did is she made diets that were screamingly deficient in lysine. And stepwise, she started to repair this deficiency by adding crystalline lysine or industrially produced lysine to the diet, measuring urinary nitrogen excretion as a response parameter. And what you see, if you repair a deficient profile, you see quite clear decrease in urinary nitrogen excretion when you have less imbalanced amino acids. And here, the optimum is considered to be the optimum. And the nice thing about this technique is that you can do this for individual pigs. So you can get an estimate of lysine requirement in individual pigs. So if you do this a lot of times and to evaluate treatment effects, you have just a lot of graphs. And every graph will give you an estimate of the optimum for every individual pig. And what you then end up with is an estimation of a different population of pigs, all with different requirements for lysine. For example, here is on the x-axis the lysine intake, and you can see that for the animals that have a low feed intake, the requirements are indicated by the different symbols. So if you're feeding 12 grams a day, you're overfeeding half of your population and you're underfeeding the other half. So there is quite a variation in individual requirements of lysine. And we use this also to estimate the effect of the energy source on the amino acid requirements for lysine. It was published by Erik Bruinings a while ago. And what he did is he compared two things. Two feeding levels, a fairly low with a one that was close to 90% of ad lib intake, and he also compared a high fat with a high starch diet, and interestingly he didn't find any difference. So the optimal lysine to energy to digestible energy ratio was identical for all of these experimental treatments. So in short, I think there is no evidence that there is an effect of energy source on the optimal lysine digestible energy ratio. So I would like to stop here and invite André for the second presentation in this series.